Hello, everyone, and welcome to this session on understanding death and rebirth. My name is Ashwin. I'm the beach yogi. I stay in a city of Pondicherry, and I've spent many lifetimes studying yoga. Also, I happened to meet one of the most amazing yoga teachers in the world and become his student. His name is Mahavatar Babaji. And he put me on the path of Nath Yoga. Particularly, I come from a sect of the Nath Yoga, which is called the Giris. So I am a Giri. Giris don't wear the big black earring that you see that Nath Yogis wear. Instead, we have a Rudraksh, a simple one. There's no other external signs that somebody is from the Giri Parampara. We don't go around greeting each other with Adesh like the Naths. We don't do any of that stuff. There are no signs. You wouldn't know that someone is a Giri except by the way they behave. And Giri means mountain. I spent a lot of time in the mountains, in crematoriums, graveyards, not crematoriums, graveyards basically. Places where burning ghats and things like that. We had to spend a lot of time there understanding death as part of my training. There are a lot of funny incidents that I remember which happened during my training, which made it very easy for me to understand what is birth, death. All of these things were a mystery to me. And I'm assuming that for most of you, death is a mystery. Because you haven't really died. You're all alive. Okay. So I want to start by defining what is death, what is rebirth. So let me begin by actually defining what is life. So, according to scientists, this is what life is. Okay, before we get started, I want to ask you guys, have you all got something to make a note of? Because you might really need a notebook and a pen. Have you? Yes. Okay. Yes. Good. Good. Okay. And if you get any more questions on the way, then just hold on to them. And when we get to the question and answer section, ask me. Okay. Most likely I might answer your question as well. And, if you're ready to go and you're excited to learn about death and life, I really need to see the energy of the group. There's 28 people here. I hope you have the high energy that is required to understand this really high energy subject. So if you've got high energy, write HE in the chat box. Have you got high energy to understand this? Okay, great. I can see that a lot of people have high energy. Fantastic, guys. This is exactly what I need. Okay, great. Okay, you can only learn as much as your energy. Okay, if your energy is low, you cannot learn. You've got to have high energy. What does high energy mean? High energy means you open, you're enthusiastic, you're focused, your eyes are open, your ears are open. You're taking in as much information as possible. That's what I want. Okay, great. Great that you have high energy. Let's begin right away. Understanding death and rebirth. Now, the first thing that I would do. Wait a minute. How do I zoom this? Just hang on. I'm looking for my mouse. The mouse, can you see it? Just a second, guys. Thanks. Okay, here's my mouse. So when I have my mouse, my life becomes easy. First of all, let's full screen this. There you go. Big enough. Main topic one. What is life? Life is determined by seven things. Did you know this? Even I didn't know this, I just looked it up. Nutrition. So we look, when we say something is alive, According to science, we see whether it eats or not. Okay, so if it's taking in information, I mean, if it's taking in food in some way, then it is alive. One of the conditions, it has to satisfy all these seven conditions. Okay, even if it doesn't satisfy one of these, then it's supposed to be dead. Respiration, it has to breathe. Okay. Even by these two counts, my teacher is dead, because neither does he breathe nor does he eat. Okay, according to science. Because science has not seen any like giris living in the mountains. Many of them don't eat and they don't breathe. And then movement. You have to be moving in some way. Something moves. Even plants have slight movement of nutrients along their body, etc. Okay. Even if the movement is microscopic, or if it's so slow that you can't see, there is movement. Or growth, yeah? No, growth is another one, sorry. Excretion, it can't be only eating, it's got to be excreting too. And then finally, growth, it has to be growing, changing into a newer version of itself. And you know, when you change into a worse version of yourself, then it's called reverse growth, right? It's like the reverse of growth. It's called decay. When you turn into a worse version of yourself. Reproduction, it seems, is a very important part to determine what is alive and what is dead. And finally, sensitivity. It should respond with its senses. How many of you are alive according to this definition? Please check. Did you eat something today? Are you breathing? Are you moving? I hope you took a dump today. Are you growing? Are you reproducing? Don't reproduce. Stop it. It's enough. There are enough people. Okay? Just stop that. Stop it right away. Then sensitivity. Are you sensitive to the environment around you? Or are you sensitive to any information inside your own thoughts? These are all senses. Okay, so that's what is alive. Now, what is death? What is death? When a living being stops any of these activities, then it is said to be dead. Death is when a living being stops living, stops doing any of those seven activities. Okay, so death is not defined by itself in general, but it's defined in general when we, this is a common definition. Okay, so this is a common definition. Common definition, it's when a living being eats. It's when a living being stops living. Okay. And what is the Nath Yoga definition? First of all, Nath Yoga definition. Okay, anything which satisfies all of this is supposed to be alive. 1 minute. Just a second. Common definition. Sorry, I'm going to add all of these here. That's a common definition. And here I want to add an Nath Yoga definition. Nath Yoga definition is any particle or wave of energy, any particle of matter or wave of energy or void of space engaged in the active fulfillment of genuine desire. This is the definition of life. I want you to take a minute and see now if you're alive or not. Okay. How many of you are dead according to this definition? Because now we have to further define a couple of things. You know what is a particle of matter, right? You know what's a wave, right? And you know that what is the void of space? It's called dark matter, which is neither energy nor matter. And it's just, they call it dark matter or dark energy. And this is just like 99% of the universe is dark matter. 1% could be wave or wave of energy or particle. So that's called nothingness. It's called nothing, formless. From the formless comes form, according to Nath Yoga. Even the formless is alive, and all the forms are also alive, and all the energy is also alive, according to Nath Yoga, if it is engaged in the active fulfillment of genuine desire. If it is not engaged in the active fulfillment of genuine desire, it is said to be dead, according to Nath Yoga. So here we have to define only one thing. What is genuine desire? Okay. And according to Nath Yoga, what is genuine desire? Genuine desire is unique and fresh and has never been had before, ever, and comes from the void, formless, not from form. It's very important definition, okay? Please make a note of these things. Genuine desire is unique and fresh and has never been had before, ever, by anybody. And it comes from the formless and not from form. So if there is already a form and then you are creating a desire for the continuance of that form, for the preservation of that form as it is, then it's not a genuine desire, because all desire comes to modify form and energy and create a new state of the universe that has never been before. Okay. So many of you think you're seeing things, you're seeing the same things, right? So now what you'll understand is that carrying ideas from the past is completely useless if you want to be alive. If you want to be dead, then you can carry ideas from the past and you will be dead. All right. Okay. Now let's see how people are doing with this information. Akhil says he's dead. I was just going to ask how many of you think that you're alive. Okay. So how many of you understood the definition? Right. Please write UTD, understood the definition. Write UTD if you understood the definition. Okay. Arshad says UTD. Shweta says UTD. Pushka, UTD. Manish understood the F. Okay, no problem. It's just a mistake. You also understood the definition. Okay, somebody is not completely. Ruchi Agarwal says not completely. Okay. Asha says, sounds like the Whiteheadian definition of creativity. Appa. So if you start understanding this with reference to something else, you'll not get it. Please refrain from doing that. Understand it as it is, okay? Kunal says UTD. Okay. Okay. So, do you mind telling me what's confusing? Somebody who's got Agarwal, do you mind telling me Chandramouli says not completely? Okay, I'm just going to explain it again. Please pay attention and please make a note of this, okay? All right. Any particle or matter or wave of energy or void of space engaged in the active fulfillment of genuine desire. This is not hard to understand. But you have to know what is genuine desire if you want to know how the definition of being alive. Okay. Genuine desire is unique and fresh and has never been had ever before and comes from the formless and not from form. Genuine desire is always to modify form. Let's add that so that you understand.
How can we unique?
I'll tell you, okay.
There are 7 billion people in the world.
Yeah. Genuine desire always modifies form. Always seeks to modify form. Fake desire. Okay, let's not add fake desire. We'll add it in another place. Okay, genuine desire always seeks to modify form. All right. Okay, now let me define the death part, then you'll become clear. Your desire, genuine desire is always unique, okay? Which means it's never been had before. So, your desire to eat food, if you think you have the same desire this morning, it's not the same. It's never been had before, okay? Actually, you want maybe something else, or you want it in a different way. Every time we want something, it's in a different way. But due to convenience, we keep doing the same routine again and again. We have the same breakfast again and again, same lunch, same dinner. We have the same sex in the same way, okay? And we have the same, I don't know, same. But you can't watch the same Netflix episode twice, have you noticed? Why? Why can't you listen to the same story twice? Once you've read Ramayana, do you want to read it again and again and again? No, right? But our government is playing it again. But you should watch. How many will watch it again, those who have already seen it? Nobody. Okay? Maybe, I don't know. If you've forgotten it, then you can see it again. Okay? But then when you see it the second time, your experience is definitely not the same. So what you want is definitely not the same experience. You want a new one. Okay? But those that seek to have the same experience again and again, that is not genuine desire, is what I'm trying to tell you. Okay? So know the difference. I hope it's clear now. So notice subtle differences. There might not be such a drastic difference between the desire, but it will still be genuine because there's a very slight difference each time. Each time it comes on, there's a very slight difference. There is definitely a change in each desire. I hope you got this. Is the definition now clear of whether you're alive or not? You have to be responding to genuine desire, otherwise you're not alive, you're dead, according to Nath Yoga. Okay? And that's what genuine desire is, always to modify yourself. The desire to maintain status quo is not genuine desire. It's just some kind of insecurity which people try to maintain things as they are. Okay? So when we allow things to change, and changes into better and better things, then you feel alive, right? Yeah, so Pramod is saying it's clear and he's partially alive, all right? Because he's trying, he wants some things to be as different. No, same, okay. So is desire all about the process re-experienced as learning? Yeah, learning and pleasure also, Asha. Desire is for learning and pleasure as well, okay? So definitely some examples of desire would be, Self-determination It's a desire. So you want to, you want to decide your future. You want to feel that it's coming from the inside and nobody else is imposing that on you. It's a very important need that we have. It's a desire. Then there's mastery. You want to become a master at something. That's the learning desire. Okay. There's also a desire for meaning, which is the desire to have a proper story from where you came and where you're going and where you are right now. That story is called meaning. And then there's also a desire for pleasure, okay? That, you know, sensory pleasure, right? You the desire to eat a delicious meal or the desire to experience some kind of art, okay? These are all sensory pleasures, or the desire to write some beautiful poetry which stimulates the mind. The pleasure for stimulation is also a desire, okay? And can the same desire not be had by others? It is never exactly the same, Chandramali. So Trisha also had this question. There are 7.3 billion people. Can they not have the same desire? They might use the same words for the desire, but when you look at it, it's not really coming from the same place. It is absolutely unique in its existence. Okay? So that's what we mean. It's a, if it's a desire to modify their life, then it's a genuine desire. It's usually coming from a real place. But if it's a desire to keep everything the same, then obviously that's not falling in line with genuine desire. That's death. Okay? Pleasure is stimulation of the senses for increased sensations, or to feel a sensation that you've never felt before is called pleasure. To feel a deeper sensation that you have. So the same thing won't give you pleasure again and again, right? So if you got a chocolate cake in front of you, the first bite gives you pleasure, but the second bite and third bite and fourth bite don't give you pleasure. Can the process of pleasure be repeated? No, that's what I'm trying to tell you, right? So the reason people find the same repeating thing pleasurable is because they haven't really paid attention the first few times. When they pay attention the first few times, they suddenly notice, then it's different, okay? So why do people do the same thing? They're doing different things inside their mind each time, okay? Which is why, Osho said that there are four people in bed. When two people have sex, there are four people in bed. The two people actually having sex and the two people that they're fantasizing about in the bed, right? So anyway, which is why, you see, the thing is that something has to change. If it's not changed, if it's not a new experience, we don't really get pleasure out of it. What we get is some kind of security, and that security equals to death. Okay, I will show you what death is now. So now is the definition of life at least clear to everybody? If it's not clear, write NC. If it's clear, write FC, fully clear. Okay. If it's fully clear, write FC. If it's not clear, write NC. Okay. FC. Okay. Everybody is FC now. No NCs. Okay. Great. Chandramali, is it clear? And Rich Agarwal, is this Ruchi Agarwal? Is it clear now? I hope so. Okay, Chandramali says clear. Waiting for Ruchi. No reply from Ruchi yet. Shweta says clear. Okay. All right, Ruchi says clear. Okay, great. Okay, guys, everybody's on the same page. Thank you very much for your patience. And now let's continue. Genuine desire always seeks to modify form, okay? And now the reason I'm going into this is that I don't want to leave anyone's understanding behind, guys. So please be patient. If you're super intelligent and you get it like this, it doesn't mean that everybody is getting on the same page. And I can't really go and define death till I have defined life properly. So now the common definition is when a living being stops living. But Nath Yoga has an active definition, okay? Nath Yoga definition is independent of the definition of life. Nath Yoga definition is when when a particle or a wave or a void of space engages in fulfilling a non-genuine desire. Okay, fulfilling this need called security, this need for to feel that nothing is going to change. Okay, what is non-genuine desire? Non-genuine desire is the desire to stay the same. That's non-genuine desire. Okay, so when you have this desire, you want everything to remain the same and not modify. When you grip that gripping, or that you can define it as many words, right? Security, you can call it grasping or gripping. Yeah, the Buddhists call it grasping, gripping, and not letting go, not allowing things to change. That's called your death. Now this body may change and change and change, and at some point it may want to not exist anymore. And that's commonly what we think as death. But in Nath Yoga, since we want things to modify all the time, we are immortal. And we don't define ourselves merely by our body. We are not only our body, we are also everybody else. We are every particle in the universe. We are the vehicle of desire. That's how we call it. We say we are Kameshwari's vehicle. The combined effect of the combined the set of all desires in the universe is called Mahakameshwari. Okay, we call that set as Mahakameshwari. It's an energy, and we say that we are vehicles of hers. Okay, one of her vehicles is a lion. She has many vehicles. One of the vehicles is a lion. Another is depicted as a tiger. Each of these have meanings. So we are those vehicles by which she transforms, she transmits herself in the universe. Okay, so that's how we understand death. Now, Hinduism talks about a cycle of life and death, but Nath Yoga is not Hinduism. Even Buddhism talks about Kala Chakra, where one soul is doing the rounds. So the soul is carrying memories of all its previous birth and etc., etc., etc. Okay, so you know what is important to do something that has never been done before? You know what is important? Memory is very important. Okay, so I'm going to make this topic memory. What exactly is memory, and where is it stored, and how is it transmitted beyond life and beyond death? Okay, let's look at it. Memory is a construction. Okay, that's why when we say remember, the word memory comes from remember. Memory means to remember, to put things together. To remember means to put everything together. So you have different limbs and you're putting them all together, and that's called memory. To remember something means to construct something. So memory is nothing but a reconstruction. Remember, when I say the word remember itself, it means reconstruct. Memory is the reconstruction of a story and has three elements. All memory has three elements: past, present, and future. So any perception that you have of your past, present and future is called memory. The units of memory are called bhutas, okay? The elements are the unit, the elements of memory are called pancha mahabhutas, five great bhutas, pancha mahabhuta. And these are what create genuinely what we call memory. Now I want you to spend a minute understanding this. Past, present and future are all constructed of the same thing, okay? Energy. And every memory has a story. It has a past, it has a present and it has a future. So when I say remember your birthday when you were 10 years old, your brain will start reconstructing. It doesn't have any memory. It starts reconstructing to match the present what it can sense. So we sense the present and then we reconstruct the past which matches the present moment. If I ask you in different times in your life to describe your 10th birthday, you'll get different stories depending on what was present at that moment. Okay. And also what story you have of the future, that also needs to get constructed. So when I ask you to present some, to construct something, you can either base it on the future, the story of the future, or the present, or the past. All right. So there are three kinds of constructions. So I hope this is making you awake and not asleep. How is your energy level? Keep it up, okay? This is all very hard to understand if you're sleeping. Wake up and stay in high energy, you'll get it. All right. Now memory consists of, has three types, okay? Three types of memory. What are the three types of memory? They are past-based memory. What is a past-based memory? A past-based memory is a story constructed with the past as a starting point, okay? So, oops, story constructed story of present and future constructed with the past as a reference point. So give me an example of this. Yeah, somebody goes to somebody's been bitten by a dog in the past, okay, and now they come face to face with a dog. They have based the story of the present and the future on their past experience of being bitten by a dog. So now they are, their present, their autonomic nervous system starts generating in accordance with the story that this dog is very dangerous. Their autonomic nervous system starts generating the appropriate state of body. And they visualize a future in accordance with this. The future will be to get away from this dog. So immediately they start moving in that direction. All movement depends on your memory. And so there are present-based memories also, okay? Okay, let's check if everyone understood past-based memories. Has everyone understood past-based memory? If you've understood past-based memory, please write, got it. Write, got it, if you got the past-based memory. Understood, says Manish. Okay, got it. Everybody's got it. Okay, very good. All right, what else are you saying? Kavya says, not taking a certain route because of the past traffic experience. Yes, correct, Kavya. That's a good example. Well done. So, yes, somebody's paying attention. I'm very happy for you. Okay. So now, let's go back. Okay, Pramod says, got it. Cool. Save this damn thing. In case my computer conks again.
Sorry?
Got it. Okay, good. Okay, now the next one is a present placement. So, we see the current environment and then we create a past and a future memory. Okay? So, currently we see all the stocks have fallen. Then we decide to buy it. And then we create a past for it and we create a future for it. We create a story. So from the past, we take the experience that I'm a genius stock trader. We take that story and then we link it to the present where the stock values are low. And then we start buying stock. And then in the future, we say, when it goes up, I've got to sell all of these and be malamal. Okay, so this is a story I have constructed with the present. So you can also call this an opportunistic memory. Okay. So story based on present possibilities and opportunities. All right. Somebody might make a past based memory also. And it all creates a story. Okay, so basically these are stories. Remember, all memories are complete stories. They have a starting point where it starts. They have what happens in between point. That's called the body of the story. And then they have a conclusion for the story, which is called a future of the story. So all three are there in a memory. You just don't realize it. When somebody asks you to remember your birthday, it's not such a simple question. A lot of stuff is happening inside your mind. All three are getting constructed. You want a context for it before you can really answer. That's why it's hard to answer some questions, okay? So suddenly if somebody comes to me and asks, are you married? Right? A lot of people do this in North India. In South India also they do it, but they'll wait until they know you well before they do it. But in the North, I've seen people coming straight and saying, are you married? Now, I want to know, before I answer this question, what's the context? Are you asking me this? Because unless I'm married, are you going, you want to rent your house only to married people? Because then I'm going to say I'm married because I want to rent your house. But if you're going to say, I don't want to rent it to married people, then I'm going to be the unmarried person. So I would like to know the context before I construct my memory. Okay. So every memory, understand, is not based on any kind of anything that exists. It is just all constructed inside your brain and you feel, you respond to every memory as if it's real. Okay, none of it is real. None of it really exists. Even the present doesn't exist. It's just not how you make it out to be. What we are seeing of the world is our interpretation by our brain. It's not exactly how the world is. Okay, this nobody can see the world as it actually is. We can only see how our brain is constructing it with all of the information coming through. For example, here's a song, okay? No Woman, No Cry by Bob Marley. If I were to actually give you the output of your MP3 player as an electric pulse onto your hand, all you would feel is a slight shock. But when I plug it into an encoder and a decoder, I forget what these things are called. Okay, encoded information gets de-encoded and then it sounds like a song to me. Now the whole song is going, no woman, no cry, and I'm listening to it. Okay, but otherwise, if I put my hand on the electrical impulse, it would just feel like a mild electrical shock. That's all it is. Bob Marley is reduced to a mild electrical shock. But otherwise, it's Bob Marley. Oh, you go get the ganja immediately, right? That's what you do, right? Stop doing that. Okay? Don't smoke up. And this whole thing of of whatever our memories are, none of it is real. There is no reality. There is nothing. Okay, reality just feels like a mild shock. If you want to experience reality without the brain and only with your nervous system, reality is a mild shock. Okay. For some of you, it's a heavy shock, and sometimes it's a mild shock. That's all reality is. It's just an impulse. It's just a vibration. Do we experience the world as just a vibration? No. We have genuine desires. We have love. We have loss. We have gain. We have beauty. We have ugliness. We have everything in our mind. Such a rich experience. It's being created not by the world. It's being created by our mind. Let's understand this once and for all. So there is no reality. That means there cannot be any lies. Anything that you actually say is a construction. Okay, so your present based memories, many people think the present is very real and genuine. No. Even this table I'm tapping is not really solid. It's just like electrical impulses, which is giving me the experience of solid table. If I were to experience it without any of that, it's just energy. It feels like a mild shock. Okay, so everybody is a mild shock. The greatest philosopher is a mild shock. The greatest love of your life is a mild shock. Your genuine calling in life is a mild shock. Okay, everything is actually a mild shock. But thanks to memory, all of it becomes the rich experience that we call life, or which we call death. Now, the third type of memory, of course, is a future-based memory. But before we do that, can we have like the temperature of the room? So Kunal is asking, how is the story different from the truth? Kunal, if you're experiencing anything other than a mild shock, it's not true. It's a construction. Let me explain this. Let me emphasize this. Okay, Kunal, I hope you got that. All right. So again, see, she's taken off on story. Asha is full of stories. She's taken a story now. Now she's saying Morpheus. Okay, it seems that the Wachowski brothers were inspired by writings in the Vedas. That's what the IT wing of BJP has been circulating. Maybe I don't know if it's genuine or not, but it is quite similar, right? The Vedas also talk about this, and Nath Yoga also talks about it. Every interpretation is a story, right? Yes. Okay, Kunal says got it. So now, does everybody understand past-based memory and future-based memory? Nath Yogini, Bhavani Ma in Chicago is the inspiration for the Wachowski brothers. No, sorry, sisters. Now they changed the reality. Yeah, and they became Wachowski sisters. Okay, so cool. Jai Bhavani. Now, every interpretation is a story. Yes, correct. Now, I want to ask you guys, are you clear about this? If you're clear, please write clear. Okay, you got this? No. Okay, great. Everybody's got past-based, future-based, and you know you do all this stuff. Yeah? Great. Okay, no problem. Very good. Well done. Now, the future-based memory. Is a story on based on future predictions. No, it's a story based on the future. Okay. So the starting point, first constructed, yeah, the first thing is the future. The future is constructed, either a bleak future or a bright future. So there's two kinds of stories here. One is bleak future and bright future. So depending on whether your future is bleak or bright, your mind. Who constructs all these stories? Mind. Okay, memory is a part of the mind, and mind constructs all these stories. So what exactly is memory? Memory is a part of the mind. A part of the mind that constructs stories and imbues the world of energy, impulses with meaning. That's what memory is. According to Nath Yoga, okay, according to science, there will be some other definition of memory. The common understanding is not what I want. If you wanted the common understanding, why come to Nath Yoga? It's commonly available on Google. Okay, so memory is a part of the mind that constructs stories and imbues the world of energy impulses with meaning. So if not for the memory, the world would only be energy impulses. Okay, the reality is nothing but a mind shock. So when people find out reality, they are mildly shocked that this is what reality is. Okay, cool. You've all had this experience, I guess. So there can be two types of stories, bleak and bright. And when the future story is bleak, then we start creating a very strong past story. We start, because past story is responsible for what you think about yourself. Okay, so a lot of self-image and image of the world is created. So there are two things that is important: self-image, and there's what I call the world image, or global beliefs. Yeah, self-belief and global belief. Self-belief and global beliefs are created from the past. So what happens is then when there's a bleak future, we create a very strong global belief and self-belief from the past, and then we try to change our actions in the present, we change our story, okay? And then we try to move away from the bleak future. When we see a bright future, then we create a bleak self-belief and global image, maybe something, I don't know. Depends, okay? It can be strong or bleak, but then we don't mind going towards the bright future. We're very happy about it. We relax our guard. We actually make a lot of mistakes after that, and we screw up. When we think the future is going to be bright, we screw up. When we think the future is going to be bleak, we take extra care and we start moving very carefully towards the future. So this is everybody's memory. Why am I telling you about memory? Because rebirth is nothing but a memory. Past birth is nothing but a memory, which is before your birthday, right? So it's a past-based memory. It's a story which is before before the day you were born. It's a continuous story that you seem to remember from before you were born. That's called rebirth. And rebirth in the future would be a story of, you know, afterlife that you construct. So rebirth can be a future story or it can be a past story as well. It cannot be a present story because this is this birth. When we say we come out of different wombs, when we came out of our mother's womb, this birth until we leave the earth is considered one birth. Okay, so what is a birth? Before we understand rebirth, we have to define what is a birth. So what is birth? Birth is nothing but occupying journey from womb to grave, let's put it as that. That's a birth, okay? And rebirth is a birth. Yeah. What is a birth? It's a journey from a womb to the grave. Basically, it's another story. And what is rebirth? Rebirth is a story of a journey to the womb. Or beyond the grave. That's what we call rebirth, right? That's what we understand as rebirth. Okay, so now that we have this clear story, clear clarity, I hope it's making sense. Let's take a check. If you got all the concepts so far, tell, say, GAC, got all concepts. If you haven't got any concept, tell me which is unclear, okay? Everybody got all concepts, great. All right, so now some people may have a question. So are rebirths not real? Are they just stories and constructions? Yes. Rebirths are not real, neither is this birth real. It's just a construction. Okay. So Pramod says, can you repeat rebirth? Yes, of course. So birth is your journey and the story from when you entered your mother's womb to when you're going to enter the grave. Rebirth is any kind of story that is either before that or after that. The story that you have of your afterlife, which you may have, everybody has the story of the afterlife. Yeah? Christians have the story, Hindus have the story, Muslims have the story, but everyone's got a story. It's not just religions who have a story, even spiritual people have a story of what will happen. They say they will not exist. That's their rebirth. Because everybody's got a rebirth story. And there is, by spiritual people, I meant like rational atheistic people, of which I am not one. And then there is also the story of, you know, how we were born. Suddenly we may remember that I was an elephant. When you remember that you were an elephant and you used to push people around and that's the root of why you're so pushy in this life, then you are visiting a past birth. And that's what you're understanding. Your brain is working with that reference. Is using that past to create a story of the future, and maybe it's not a good thing for you. So you need to white out that memory and finish it off. You need to finish off that memory, finish off that past birth, saying, I don't need that. Okay? So a lot of people are running their life based on past-based memories, past-based constructions. That's why human life is very interesting. It has layers and layers and layers. And when we work with death and rebirth, we're able to, you know, the idea of Nath Yoga is to avoid death completely and to keep working on rebirth, to keep working on the memories, okay? So Pushkar is asking, what carries a memory from one birth to another and what else is carried? Now, it appears that we are carrying memory from one birth to the other. There's absolutely no way to know whether this is true or not. But you can certainly find and construct these stories. So how does it carry? Nothing is carried, it's constructed, Pushkar. Hey, pay attention, dude. I didn't say that memories exist by themselves. They're constructed in the moment. If I ask you to remember the glass of water you drank in the morning, you're going to have to construct it. It doesn't exist. You're going to construct it right now. Yeah. So based on, when you construct it, you can use like the past as a starting point and construct it based on a past. The story begins in the past, the construction starts in the past, and it matches the present, and then you match the future to it. All get constructed unconsciously. You may not be conscious, but all three get constructed at once. And if you look into your memory, you'll find that all three are actually existing, the past, the present, and the future. I hope you got it, Pushkar. Kavya asks, if nothing is reality, can construction of stories and narrative be reconstructed based on desire? Yes, of course, Kavya, and that is called yoga. Okay? So a genuine desire comes out from nothingness, from emptiness. Comes from the formless, comes the desire for form. And learning how to identify that and construct your future and past according to that, that's called yoga. So yoga is balancing all of these things. Yoga is the consistency between genuine desire and your memories. When genuine desire matches your memories, you are called a yogi. And what will be your experience of life as a yogi? You will have a wonderful experience here. You will have just so much happiness and bliss living in this world. You don't have to wait for an afterlife to be happy in yoga. Okay? In every other system and philosophy, you have to do a lot of work to be happy. But in yoga, you can start being happy right now. You don't have to wait for it. And that's, you can be happy in the middle of pain. Yeah, right now I'm in a lot of pain. You don't know, right? If you look at my face, you don't know I'm in a lot of pain. But years ago, two things happened. I tried to save, I rescued someone. I rescued somebody who was kidnapped. And I got caught by the kidnappers when I was around 14 or something. And I got beaten so badly that I had spinal injuries. And those injuries sometimes aggravate. Okay, so I've got those injuries, right? Now, is this a past-based story or what? This is a memory. It's a construction. But my present is being constructed based on that. Because it's such a good story, I don't want to let go of it. So now I can't let go of it. But yeah, I have to let go of it if I want. But coming from my past. And then another thing happened. There was a concert in Bangalore where someone lifted someone on their shoulders and I lifted them on my shoulders. Basically, three people, two people sitting on my shoulders, one above the other. And then we danced on top of that. So from there, my lumbar region got some issues. And sometimes when I exercise, it just suddenly aggravates and shows up once in a while. Okay. Very rare it had become. And recently, like 2 days ago, it's shown up again. After I did some taekwondo, I decided to practice taekwondo after a long time. So I did all the axe kicks and everything. And I felt really great. And by evening, I got these really bad cramps, which are still not gone. So I'm in a lot of pain right now. Yeah, but so even if you are in a lot of pain, you can be happy if your story is good. All right? So Pushkar says, I didn't understand completely. What's the link between births for reconstruction? There's no link, Pushkar. You just reconstruct right where you are. There's absolutely no link. It just seems like that, okay? So Katie's asking, how can you differentiate between true desire and false desire that lead to delusion and suffering? Okay, very easy distinguishing factor between true desire and false desire is that true desire wants things to modify. You want things to change. When you want things to change, you're on the right track, okay? And if you want things to remain the same, that's when you start suffering. The more number of things you want to remain the same, the more you're going to suffer. Because that's a desire based on a memory. That's a desire based on us, you know. This is security, fear. It's based on that, right? We don't, it's not a desire based on, oh, the world is an awesome place and let me just play around here. Let me change things. That happiness will not be there. Okay? So I hope that's clear, Katie. Cool. Pushkar, if it's clear, please write clear. There is no link between births. There's nothing like that. That's also a story. The construction that we make between births, it's also a story, but doesn't mean that you experience it as less real. It is a real experience for those who are experiencing it, right? So if you make up the story that everything is the story, that's also a story. And the way you react, that will be your reality. If you make up a story that everything is a story, but everything is worthy of your respect, then your reaction will be even different. So what we tell to ourselves is really important. The way we speak to ourselves, the way we, the self-belief and global beliefs play a huge role also. Okay, so it's all happening simultaneously, which is why healing is possible. What is disease? Disease is a feeling of discomfort with the world. That's disease. And healing is feeling that everything is right with the world. You know? Healing is genuine love for the world. That's when you start healing. Okay? If you start hating the world, something's wrong, I got to fix it, you're not going to heal anything. You start with, the world is beautiful and I'm going to make my own story now. That's healing. Is it possible to feel happy by engaging in activities that make me feel secure? How? No, no way. If you engage in activities that build your security, you'll never feel happy. You'll always feel afraid. You'll go on protecting yourself. Okay? Nobody who is protecting himself is happy. Nobody is protecting himself or herself is happy. These are just two mutually exclusive neurological states. Protection happens from the sympathetic nervous system and the dorsal vagal nervous system. But happiness happens from the ventral vagal nervous system. Okay? It's just two different places that these two things come from. Okay, but they're not, according to Nath Yoga, they're not coming from any nervous system. They're just like two different places called falsehood and joy. Okay, there is no reality. There's only joy and falsehood. Everything that does not bring joy is false. That's it. Okay, I hope it's I hope it's sobering you guys, this knowledge. Yeah, I hope it's ironing you out and settling you down and you know, giving you tools to actually understand your own mind. I hope it's doing all these things. Okay? Shweta says it's beautiful. Great. I'm glad you find it beautiful. So I think so too. Okay? Cool. So then everything that we struggle with is just one of these things, and we need to just like change it. You know, there's techniques. This just attending this lecture itself, you'll get a lot of techniques. You can construct your own techniques. You can make your own spiritual practice by understanding these things and design your life so that you're always enjoying, always building new things, right? Okay. Kunal, you ask yourself, man, you've engaged in activities that make you secure. Have you got any joy? Yeah. You don't get joy by chasing security, or all you get is a certain, what do you call it, vigilance. Who can be happy while conducting vigilance? Okay, so some people, they take that vigilance, and vigilance is always stress. It's providing stress chemicals into your body, and their vigilance kills them. So many things to worry about. Yeah, yesterday somebody was telling me that Should I face south or should I face north while meditating? Should I face east? And then, bro, why are you meditating in the first place? Okay. And yesterday somebody was asking me, how should I meditate? And I'm like, why do you want to meditate? What for? You don't have to meditate. What should you meditate for? For calm and peace. You don't meditate for calm and peace. You make new desires and you create, construct a different story. Then you'll have calm and peace. Okay? You can't meditate for all of these things. It's not called, you can't sit and focus on a mantra and expect peace to come. It doesn't happen like that. Okay. So Kunal says, no, I had never found happiness in the pursuit of security unless it's a false construct that those happy activities make you happy. So you can't construct like that. Right? If you say something is actually making you happy, there's a difference between happy and high. Okay, guys. Know there's a difference. It's very important. To construct happy, there's only one way. To participate in genuine desire, then only you can be happy. To participate in the fulfillment of genuine desire, then happiness can happen. But if you can get high. To get high is to take a drug and create an elevated state of mind where you feel a maniacal state of mind. That's called being high. So it's mania, right? Everyone knows mania. Mania is when you just feel that everything is so awesome. And it's a temporary state. And after this state of mania, there's always followed by a low. This high is always followed by a low. Have you noticed? It's like taking MDMA. How many of you have taken MDMA? Okay, don't answer that. It's an illegal drug. But those of you who have taken ecstasy or MDMA, you realize everything looks so much more beautiful. How nice everything is. So nice. And then you feel low the next day. You feel depressed. Because it's extracted so much serotonin from you, then there is no more serotonin left, and then you have a serotonin depletion for a couple of days, and then you want to have more MDMA after that. Okay, great. I hope you all got this, and this is my understanding of Nath Yoga's teachings about death and rebirth. Life, death and rebirth. So what do you use this knowledge of life, death and rebirth for? One of the defining practices is called Yoga Nidra. With Yoga Nidra, we can move between births. We can move in the in-between spaces between birth and rebirth. Okay, so there's one more thing, what the Tibetans call bardo, and we also use the same word in Nath Yoga. It's called bardo. Okay, bardo is a in-between space. It's a twilight zone. Or connecting zone between births. So in your rebirth, there's something called bardo. In Nath Yoga, it's actually considered a part of rebirth. You had to pass through like a in-between zone. Okay, so here's all I wanted to tell you about death and rebirth. Now I'm going to tell you about what Yoga Nidra is. Okay. So that you can understand in more detail. Now also let me tell you what are the uses of understanding a past birth or a future birth. What are the uses of understanding that? Because I get a lot of patients who have a lot of psychological problems, and when I look there, the cause for that is always in the a story from the past. The trigger for their psychological problems is a story from the past. And sometimes that story is not in this birth. It's coming from another birth. It's a construction which is coming from another birth. And so when I am able to take them there and modify that, change the understanding of that, then their present experience changes. Okay, they're no longer affected by that. Even their physiology changes. I'm able to cure a lot of diseases with this. Healing is something you can do by just manipulating the stories. Things just change and heal. Okay, so Katie has another question. The world is constructed by a lot of false desires. How do you recommend navigating this energy to bring out the true desires? We are in contact with systems and people enacting false desires every day. How to move freely to bring forth true desires amid such constructs? So when we start speaking from a genuine place, when we ourselves are coming from the idea that everything changes, it resonates, and we, our vibe attracts our tribe. Okay, so please note down that your vibe attracts your tribe, and the way the beliefs that you have, if you're one of the security, then you really clearly fall into another tribe. And if you're the one which discards security and wants progress, then you're falling into another tribe. So your vibe, just genuinely be who you are, what you believe in, and such people will come to you. You don't have to put any effort, Katie. You will be joined by such people, but just be consistently putting out the message through your body language, through your Facebook posts, through your Instagram posts, and all of your social media, and your writings, your blog, your videos. Just keep putting out the same message that you believe in, and eventually it becomes a huge movement when you are able to be consistently responding to your genuine desires. You just attract people who respond to the genuine desires. Okay, that's how it is. I know that's your experience too. Everybody's experience. When you start off, you're nothing. You're just giving off a vibe, just creating an energy field. That energy field just starts attracting. What advertising does a flower do? A flower just produces nectar and sits. Bees come to it and then take out that nectar and then pollinate the flower. And then fruits are created, right? There would not be fruits without pollinating agents, right? Trees don't have sex. They need insects for them to have sex. So in a similar way, even we are not like dogs, right? We don't get into heat and then, you know, you go out emitting smells and then attracting humans to mate with us. I mean, the female gets into heat and attracts a male to mate. No, our sexuality is more complicated than that. So that's how our attraction works, even in humans. It's very different. Yeah, human attraction, we are attracted depending on our mission. And we have a certain mission, then we attract a certain kind of people over there. So the mission is nothing but a story. Humans use stories to attract, but animals use energy to attract. We don't attract with energy, because for us, every energy is turned into a story. So we rarely experience the mind shock that other animals experience as reality. It's just a buzz. For most animals, reality is a buzz. But since we have memory, reality for us is very rich. It is more than just a buzz. And even animals have memory. It's a different kind of memory, not like ours. Okay? Memory doesn't depend on your brain. Even when your body is dead, gone, every cell has, every particle of the universe has memory. Every wave of energy in the universe has memory. So everything has memory in this world. And then when a lot of particles and waves band together, then here now you get something. Ashwin, the beach yogi. It's just a bunch of agreeing molecules and energy. I'm just a bunch of agreeing energy and molecules. Yeah. So is it possible for you to get more molecules to agree with you, Katie? Yes, of course it's possible. Just make sure that all your molecules are not conflicted and are constantly agreeing with each other. Then you have greater energy field. If you have a fragmented energy field, then you attract fragmented people. If you have a clear energy field, then you attract clear people. Okay, so now stop wondering about why there are so many idiots in your life. If you have idiots in your life, then you are the idiot. Okay, So it's our fragmented energy that attracts more people with fragmented energy. And that's when we create like a comedy of errors in our life. Okay, just start to get consistent. And that's why we use this tool, which I call Yoga Nidra. Okay, so where is this tool? It's here. So Yoga Nidra is a, what exactly it is? Yeah, yoga, I told you, is the pursuance of genuine desire. The pursuance of genuine desire, the fulfillment in the pursuance of genuine desire is called yoga. And Nidra means sleep. So it's a kind of sleep slash dream practice within yoga that allows you, it's a dream and sleep practice that allows you to iron out your story. Iron out your memories and construct a strong story. So basically, you go out of your body every night and you visit different perspectives, make changes, and you come back remembering the experience. So it is a combination of lucid dreaming and astral traveling and all of that kind of stuff. But it also brings coherence in your life. Okay, so it's a tool for coherence. It integrates everything together. It integrates all your fears and your whatever you want to own, your desires and fears, whatever you want to own of these, Yoga Nidra helps you to integrate it, so you're no longer a fragmented being. And it leads to genuine power. It's like, you know, when you take an iron bar and it has no magnetism, but if you keep stroking it with a bar magnet, this becomes magnetic too, because inside everything aligns. So Yoga Nidra is a tool for inner alignment. Oops. It's a tool for inner alignment, which leads to a field of energy that is strong. Leads to a powerful, powerful field of energy and purposeful. That is in the service of new desire. Fresh, genuine desire. So that's what happens there. And then all you have to do is then let things happen. You keep practicing Yoga Nidra, and then you just, every day you just let things happen. So I've already started a course on Yoga Nidra and I teach it. So if you want to be a part of the course, then I'll tell you what to do. But right now, let's see if you've got any questions so far. Any questions so far? I hope it's all understood. Yeah. Katie says it's clear. Okay. So if you've got it all so far, I'm going to go and start answering questions, and then it'll become interesting because I've got 28 people who've asked questions. Let's answer them one by one. If we can go on to answering questions, just write AQ. If I can go on to answering questions, write AQ. But if you've got a question, type your question. Okay? AQ, answer questions. In case, yeah, okay. You have no more questions. Great, great, great. Answer questions, answer questions, answer questions, says everybody. All right, super. Great, guys. Thanks for maintaining the high energy. I hope this thing went in. I'll send you the recording as well. Just listen to it and understand these things well, and suddenly you'll feel great peace. Yeah. Anytime you want to feel peace, watch this talk. Okay. Now, let me just continue with the questions. Boom. Google Forms. No idea why my internet is so slow. Okay, no idea why this is, guys. Let me access them from somewhere else. Give me a second, yeah? Yeah, Shweta, you can share this talk anywhere. And I don't know what's going on with this. 1 minute, huh? Oh yeah, finally it's open. Understanding that. And Rebirth. Fantastic. 28 responses. Let's begin. Okay, it's back, guys. Let's start. First question is from Ankur, and he asks, why does the cycle exist? There is no cycle that exists, Ankur. Now you're relieved to know. Okay, that's just how it seemed, and when it seemed like that, people made that theory. According to Nath Yoga, there's no cycle that exists. There's no cycle to break out of. Okay, next question. Ankur asks, are people able to exit the cycle? Again, this question is invalid because there is no cycle of death and rebirth as Buddhism and some parts of Hinduism propagate. And then let's see. Are there souls? Many people ask if there are souls, then how does the population increase? Where are the new souls coming from? Okay, so there is no concept of souls in Nath Yoga at all. All right? Everybody is considered... everything is considered to have to be able to experience itself as an individual or as a collective or as the mild shock, which we call reality. This is called Ida, Pingala, and Sushumna. So we can experience ourselves as any of these three things. So the population increases because people are having too much sex, unprotected sex. And where are the new souls coming from? Nobody has a soul, so there's nothing to worry about. What a relief. Next. Ankur asks, what's the importance of the cycle that you have that I have presumed to exist? Now you don't need to presume this anymore? Do I need to know them? No. How does previous birth impact me? Just like a memory impacts you, if it creates what we call global beliefs and self-belief. So depending on your global belief and self-belief, it affects the range of your actions, okay? Therefore, it's important to know your previous birth and see how it impacts you and change it if it does impact you. Does it give me any advantage to know the previous births? Of course. When, if it's affecting you, then you need to go in there and find out where these global beliefs came from. What is the memory holding those global beliefs and change that memory, all right? Cool. Next. Why do Abrahamic religions not have any concept of rebirth while Indian religions seem to have the concept? Well, you know now, okay? Okay, because obviously the question of rebirth, the definition of rebirth is different. And, you know, Nath Yoga also has a concept, but the definition of birth, rebirth, life, everything is different in Nath Yoga, which makes things easy. But in other religions, they take difficult definitions of life and death, and then they bring in rebirth, and you know, so they also have a concept of soul and afterlife. It's a different way to construct a story, okay? Different stories. All religions are stories. Okay, next. What all questions from Ankur over? What is the path that remains constant across births? Across birth, what remains constant is that you have memories, and whatever properties belong to any particle or wave, those properties apply constantly across births. I know this is some kind of spiritual question propagated by somebody, probably means something very much to them. But what you'll do with this is completely useless question, okay? If you want to fulfill new desires, you don't need to answer this question. The whole search for constancy is the search of security, which is false desire, according to Nath Yoga. Your whole search for constancy is false desire. Okay, Ankur. Then, anonymous asks, what is the proof of rebirth? There is no proof. Is there a way to delay death, or is there a fixed time when a person dies? Definitely a way to delay death. Stop eating non-veg, stop drinking milk, work out, have good relationships, be joyously engaged in genuine desire, and you will be alive, okay? As long as you're joyously engaged in the pursuit of genuine desire, you won't die. Then, if rebirth actually happens, is there a way to free oneself from this cycle of death and rebirth? No, there is no cycle, so you're already free. Kindly explain. Yes, I try to say it as kindly as possible. You don't have to worry about this. You're free. You're genuinely the creator of your own life. Okay, great. Can we or our karma choose in which species or in which social, economical, physical, mental status we are reborn in? Yeah, you can totally choose this. Yeah, it's your memory. Do what you want. How to live at that time of death? You have no regrets or guilts or desires. Live that at the time of death. Okay, how to live so that at the time of death, you have no regrets or guilt or desires. Not at the time of death, you should have no regrets or guilt even now. All right, just understand that guilt is a useless emotion, and it's coming up from the idea, and this is an important idea, everybody please pay attention, it's very important. Many people have the idea that things could have gone differently, if only they had. Let me break the news to you. Everything happens because it's possible. It was the only possibility, that's why it happened. If there was a different possibility, then it would have happened. Otherwise, it's not called a possibility. It's just a probability. There is no such thing as probability, okay? It's a mathematical concept, but in reality, there is only one possibility, and that's the one that happens. And when that happens, we start feeling something called guilt, because we feel that somehow, artificially, we could produce a possibility that the whole universe could not produce. I don't know why. So drop guilt and regret. And it's something that you just don't construct into your memories, okay? And how to be free from desire. Nobody's free from desire. Even the desire to be free from desire is a bloody desire. So wake up and embrace desire. Don't be desire negative. Something our religion teaches you, okay? How to live at the time of death? That is done. If rebirth actually happens, what time after death are we reborn? At the time you reconstruct your past, you're reborn. Yeah. Anytime you start focusing on genuine desire and allowing things to change, then you are reborn. Can you put some light on suicide and euthanasia? Suicide is probably it's a falsehood, because you really can't kill yourself. Yeah, I mean, you do kill yourself by wanting things to remain the same, or wanting. But people who commit suicide are the ones who feel either they feel curious about what's going to happen after I die, and then the next time maybe they don't do. Next time around, maybe that memory is not there. You know, if any of the memories of this birth are carried over into another birth, maybe that person carries the learning that suicide is not a good idea. Because suicide is completely, it's just like, either it can be a genuine desire because you want to change. Yeah, but there are people who commit suicide just for that, just to know what's up. But most of the time, suicide is because you are you're suffering too much in this birth. I'll tell you the root of all suffering. The root of all suffering is wanting things not to change, or wanting them to change into something that is not possible for them to change. Wanting something impossible, or wanting things not to change, leads to suicidal thoughts. Because you want to quit this building because nothing is going according to expectations. And most of the time, expectations are not our own. No baby is born with expectations, learns expectations from society. So a person who has learned in and taken in a lot of expectations of how they should be are the ones who get closer and closer to suicide. The more expectations you have, the closer you are to suicide. Okay? Euthanasia is to kill off somebody because they're in too much pain, and I think it's perfectly all right. If you know, somebody is in too much pain and they want to die, it's totally all right. You can inject them with something fatal and the body dies. It's a pain relief method, okay? So both suicide and euthanasia can be methods to relieve pain. And then you start over, maybe, I don't know. But then you won't remember this birth. Why would you remember a suicide birth? But if you do, then yeah, then you carry that story, okay? So suicide is, you quickly end the story. It's like switching off the TV. Okay, then let's see what next. Shobha asks, what happens after death? Does the spirit leave immediately? You assume there is something called a spirit, which is not really there. And what happens after death? Life happens after death. When you realize death is stupid, then you start living again, okay? According to the Nath Yoga definitions. Please don't go by the conventional definitions to understand my statement that you start living after death immediately. Okay, so anybody who's dying, congratulations, your next option is only life. Anybody who's alive, congratulations, continue to be alive. Okay, we're all immortal, we don't die. Then, we die by our own choice. Okay, what decides our rebirth, whether human, animal, etc.? At the time of death, what stories you are aware of, that determines the continuation of the story. Okay, so at the time of the ending of the physical body, when it is no longer able to work, you don't die, but you just, whatever you remember is going to determine whether you become, whether you find yourself in a human womb or an animal womb, or wherever you find yourself, wherever your story will change according to that. So yeah, I hope that's clear. If anything is not clear so far, and just stop this and ask me. Anything is not clear. Okay, let's see. Kavya asks, when genuine desires and actions stay as a memory, can that memory lead to a further genuine desire? Yeah, of course. Genuine desire, it can appear to come from memory, because maybe it seems continuous and we like to link things up, right? So we reconstruct our memories, but actually, strictly speaking, the source of genuine desire is coming from emptiness. It does not need any past. It can just come out from the formless to the form. That's how emptiness to form. The formless is thrashing to exist as form. Okay, so whether there's a memory or not, it does not need a beginning. Okay, hope that's clear. I have a private question. Why do people meet again with whom we have had traumatic experience in past birth? Do we only get this desire, and why? Okay, so we may remember some of the people that we have in this birth as being with us in a past birth. And the continuation of trauma, you know, somebody can curse you in a past birth, and if you accept that curse, if it becomes part of your story, then it's like my back pain, you know. It starts to actually come, and you like that story so much that you start having this pain. So they can be painful and it can be traumatic. And do we only get this desire, and why? Yes, you only create this. You accept the story. So the moment you hold the story as, oh yeah, it's spectacular, you find the story spectacular in some way, either negatively or positively, so you decide to hold on to that story. Okay, if you let go of the story, then it's gone. And in the erasing trauma, this is what I teach in my course. I teach you how to let go of stories. So that's all right. Okay, Katie says, can you go back to the point you mentioned about experiencing the collective? Okay, so we have three perspectives, and I'm going to do a talk on the three perspectives also one of these weekends. And the three perspectives are like this. One is built from within the body, and that's what we call selfhood. It just seems like we are an individual and there are others and all that. And then we can empathize with them. That's the second perspective. And the third perspective is the mind shock. So when you say collective, it can be two things. It can be empathy, deep empathy, and you matching up, your story is matching up with other people's story as well. And that's called being a collective. Or there's a bigger collective, which is energy. And your story is matching up with the momentum of energy, that impulse which is traveling through the world, you know, which is like the seed or the bija or the signal. You start tuning into the signals, and that's spiritual collective. Okay, so you have the human collective and you have a spiritual collective, and you can tune into either of those. Various shamans have various names for these kind of things, and various tools for these kind of things. Our tool is yoga nidra. Many people use ayahuasca as a tool, and many people use ganja as a tool. But then all of those tools are really bad for your liver, okay? So yoga nidra is a liver-friendly tool. There are other liver-harming tools to alter your state of mind and get there. But yoga nidra is a perfect way without harming your liver to get any place. All right. So great. Now I'm going to continue with the questions. If you have any questions, just leave it here. I'll keep checking back. All right. This is done. Avirupas kindly explain prarabdha in terms of death and rebirth. So prarabdha is a kind of karma which we say is prepared for a birth. Okay, prarabdha is what you come, it's the story you come prepared with, and then the story can change. Yeah, so prarabdha is just like something you think will happen, but it may or may not execute depending on where you get distracted and what else you come to do. But generally speaking, prarabdha is your life's purpose. Right. I spoke about this last week and that recording got lost, so maybe I'll do that talk again, I don't know. But yeah, so that's prarabdha. All right, I hope you understood that, Agaru. And if you are here, the people who are asking questions, and if you're here and I haven't answered your question to your satisfaction, just leave a comment in the chat box, either privately or anonymously, and I'll speak to you. Privately or non-anonymously, and I'll speak to you right now. Anonymous asks, after death, how many days will it take to enter into a new body? Instantly. Instantly you can find yourself in a new home. How many cycles of birth do we take? Infinite. There are no cycles. It's just like you can experience infinite wombs. Now, Vibrat, is it possible to die and not be reborn? It's possible to hold on to a state of death, which according to Nath Yoga is trying to make things not change. Yeah, that's what people do. They get stuck in many places trying to hold on like that. What happens then is the energy becomes very sluggish and you feel a lot of pressure and you feel depressed and you feel mental. Okay, so that's what happens if you want to die and not be reborn. A lot of people are dead and not being reborn. Okay, a lot of people are like this. What happens between births? Between births is what we call bardo. It's another experience of rest, a kind of rest where you construct memories, and when you construct memories, you're again immediately born. You find yourself in a womb again. Yuvraj asks, how to die peacefully? Death, according to Nath Yoga, or when the body is dying, what do you do? So maybe what you're asking is how to die painlessly. Okay, there is no way to leave this body without pain. If you want to disintegrate this body, a part of your brain will be aware as the body is disintegrating. Till the brain dies, you're going to feel things. Okay, there's no painless death. Every death is painless, painful. Whether the person is screaming or not, whether they look peaceful or not, internally they have experienced a lot of pain, but it's not a big deal. Pain is just an electrical impulse. Okay. So look at me, I'm in pain right now and I'm totally all right, right? I'm even not finding it easy to breathe right now with this pain. But it depends on what you do with it, okay? If you understand your pain in a context that makes it all right and it's not a problem, then it's okay. You don't have to feel pain. I mean, you don't need to respond to it like how everybody loses their head for a little pain, right? But you have to understand that pain is just a strong sensation. It's nothing. Not a big deal. Okay. Abhirami asks, what factors determine the kind of life in the next birth? Are we reborn as other species as well? Yes, of course, you can be go to other wombs as well. You can experience any kind of womb. And what factors determine the kind of life in the next birth? The stories, the memories that you carry, the memories that you construct determine which womb you land in and what story you have. Okay? Good. Ritika asks, why do we fear death? Is it a painful process? Yes, all death is painful. That's why we fear it. Why birth and death is not in our hand, except highly evolved yogis? Well, birth and death is definitely in your hand. Stop wanting things to be same and you'll not die. Okay. Highly evolved yogis, they take Maha Samadhi and so-called Ichha Mrityu. What's that? No idea. According to me, highly evolved yogis do not die. And so I don't know what this Mahasamadhi business is. Maha Samadhi is advertising your brand so that, you know, the followers who are there are the ones who say, the guy who's taken Maha Samadhi doesn't say Maha Samadhi, he's just dead, right? Everybody props him up in a seated position after he's dead, and the body, you know, you get rigor mortis, the body becomes stiff like that, and then the person appears like he died sitting. That arrangement of sitting is done after the person dies by their students, so that they can use that brand and make more money, I guess. I don't know. Not really exactly sure. Where do we go? It's not my story, so I'm not really sure about it. But according to me, real yogis don't die, because they're always working on genuine desire. Where we go when we die? You first go to a bardo and then you're reborn. Do we meet our loved ones who have already left up in heaven when we die? Yes, sometimes we do. Okay, and that's a continuation of the story. Okay, usually when you have a real strong pact on the earth, and when someone dies, they do meet their loved ones after they die. Okay, then Anonymous asks, why does the perspective of death differ for different religions, and how do we know which one is right? I like the Nath Yoga perspective of death, so I'm sticking to that. It makes a lot of sense to me, but all religions have their own stuff. None of it made sense to me, so you choose one which makes sense to you, right? So yeah, how do you know which one is right? No religion is right, because they have some weird concept that really didn't make any sense to me. But if you find anything that makes sense, please send it along. I would love to read. Okay? But to me, the Nath Yoga definition of death, working on keeping things the same, as death, I experience it also as a kind of death. I feel this. I kind of agree with this very deeply. Okay? I hope this talk has changed your perspective. Anonymous asks, is there a way to escape death? Not to lengthen life for the sake of it, but to enjoy it further. Yes, this is called yoga, not yoga. Okay, learn it. Then Anonymous asks, is there any preparation required before you die? If so, what is the right age for it? You prepare for death from when you're born, okay? Just prepare to avoid death by actually always choosing a new desire. Okay? Allowing genuine desire to come inside you. It's a practice. If you practice it, you keep coming inside. You realize this. You know? You don't want things to be the same. Wanting things to be the same is a very fast way to die. And so there's no right age. As soon as you get your senses and you can understand this, start practicing it. I started practicing yoga at the age of 4, I think. Anyway, what's this? Anonymous says, the resultant of suicide and death. The resultant of suicide and death are same. Yeah, you end up in a bardo and you're reborn. Yeah, same there. And Anonymous asks, how far can a soul travel to get into a womb? And which semester do these wombs start accepting souls? How do we know if there's a soul in the womb already? There's no soul. Okay? The moment the embryo is formed, it's already got a mind. Everything has a mind. Okay, so if you're asking when is the right time to abort and not murder, there is no such thing. Just be careful in the first place. Don't have babies. Okay. Next one. Shailaja asks, I have heard this concept. We have all come from different sources and galaxies, and once we die, we're given a choice to either go back to our source or experience more of what life has to offer. We are totally not bound by karma or anything, no matter what we have done while the body here on earth. Each time we die, we have a choice to go back home, but repeatedly we choose to come back on earth. It's a nice story. If that's what the memory you want to have, it is true for you. Okay? Good. Kunal asks, how do we prepare for death? By getting indoctrinated into the idea that things have to be the same and you have to seek constancy. You prepare for death and you invite death and you die also. How is samadhi different from death? If you mean how do you prepare for the inevitable wrenching of the, what is it called? Disintegration of the cells of your body. You don't have to disintegrate unless you want to, okay? Just don't do it. Start pursuing genuine desire and you won't die. You just won't be dead. How is samadhi different from death? No difference. I don't know what people talk about anyway. What Patanjali calls samadhi is very different, yeah? He calls it the continuous concentration on the idea that genuine desire, of the idea of genuine desire, and continuously concentrating on that is called samadhi, according to Patanjali. And it's very different from death. But otherwise, generally what people call samadhi after someone dies, they achieve mahasamadhi, it's just death. What is the meaning of aghora? Aghora means non-violent. And aghora is a way to not be antagonistic to anything in the universe, to accept everything as valid. Not to say that some things are evil and some things are special. An aghori embraces all. And an aghori is also ready to eat human flesh because he understands human being is just energy, nothing else. And the acceptance of the mild shock of reality is called aghora. Many mythologies speak of aghoris even eat shit and even drink piss. And the one aghori I knew, he came into a mandir and pissed on the shivling. And then nobody got butthurt because he's an aghori. And when they went there, there was no smell of urine. It was smelling sweet. When everybody took it as prasad. Okay. When I was in Varanasi. Many mythologies speak of rebirth to avenge some past life evil. Can this be the purpose for rebirth? If you carry that story, yes, Kunal. Otherwise, no. You don't have to make that some kind of story. It's a subtle story, according to me. Then Pramod asks, can we remember our past life? Of course, Pramod. Is there a procedure for that? Of course. Is it safe to do so? Of course. It's called Yoga Nidra. Join my Yoga Nidra course and you'll learn all these things. In the first week itself, second week itself, you'll learn all these things. If you join my Yoga Nidra course. All right. Then, 1 minute. Can we contact people who have passed away but not reborn yet? You can contact them even if they're reborn, okay? If they're passed away, reborn, yes, you can definitely contact them, no problem. It's all possible through Yoga Nidra. And how does rebirth happen? Is it time-based, event-based, or is there a specific criteria that needs to be met? Rebirth happens by your memories. So whatever memories you carry as precious, you hold on to as precious, that those stories get reenacted and you choose a womb in which you can feel some continuity from these stories. So you choose that. So yeah, no criteria to be met. Just have a good story, you have a good rebirth. Then Anonymous asks, is there life after death? Of course, man. If yes, will our deeds from the present life play a role? No, not your deeds, your memories. Okay. Anonymous asks, why do we fear death and how to overcome that fear? See, because we have memories, we know that when the body disintegrates, it's painful, right? Even when we get a cut, we see that it's pain. So when we're losing the whole body, we can conclude that it's painful. And there's no need to overcome that fear. Just don't destroy your body, honestly. Why do we fear death even more when we see those whom we love suffering and dying? Because it is painful. Death is painful. I mean, the death, like you define it, disintegration of the body is very painful. Is it possible to accept the traumas associated with watching those we love dying? Yeah, you can, of course, integrate anything into any story. And I'm totally okay when people I love undergo a lot of pain and die. What to do? They're going to die, they're going to die. How do we deal with those we love who are wanting to die and not really making an effort to make the most of, most to value life as we're meant to? So people who are going to die are the ones who want things to be different, either from what reality is, like what their experience is, what is possible. Okay, they want something that's not possible. They either want impossible things or they want things not to change. And those are the people that die. And so it's okay. It's their journey of learning. You can't do anything for them to learn. Yeah? It's definitely not possible, yeah, to... Is that not possible to teach somebody anything if they have not signed up for your course? Okay. They haven't given consent. Consent is where the basic necessity for teaching. If somebody's not given you consent, you can't teach them. Please tattoo this somewhere. Okay. Cannot teach without consent. Nice tattoo to have here. Cannot teach without consent. Okay, good. Remember this. Okay. Is valuing life overrated? Is it? No, it's not. Life is very valuable. Is it possible that overwhelming attachment we have with our bodies and our experiences is preventing us from accepting death more gracefully? No, death is painful. No matter how much you imagine, it's not painful. The nerves will pain when you die. Okay, so why you want that pain unnecessarily? Okay. Everyone knows death is painful and everybody's rightly scared of death. What's the problem? Just don't die. Can we choose our death and the way we would like to leave this world? Why would you want to leave this world? Okay. If you want to leave this world, you can choose your death. Yeah. People who committed suicide are the ones who did choose their death. People who got caught in accidents are the ones who didn't choose their death, or so they think, but their life's choices landed them there unconsciously. So in a way, they also chose their death. What can be done on a daily basis to grow a graceful acceptance towards the idea of death, or not just self, but those we are connected to? Yoga Nidra. No other way. Okay? No other way that I know of, and the most efficient way that I know of is called Yoga Nidra. And how can we deal with the trauma of death post the death of a loved one? This is very simple. You find the traumatic thought, you find the root memory, and you re-understand the lesson that is causing that, the lesson there, okay? The lesson that's causing the traumatic thought, you re-understand the lesson, and that thought won't be caused anymore, and you'll be free of the trauma, and you then just wipe out that thing. This is the first step process of getting out of trauma. It's very easy to do. I can teach you. Okay. What do we do about the regrets we may have with a particular person who has passed away? How do we deal with life and living with those regrets? Again, all those regrets are all trauma. So you find the thought that's causing you discomfort. You find the root memory. When did you learn that? When did you learn that thought? And then from the memory, you re-understand that memory. You reconstruct the memory. It's called Smritiakarshana. You reconstruct that memory. And boom, you have a new experience with that memory. You don't have that experience anymore. You're free from the trauma. Okay? Great. It's a very effective process and I'm helping people with it. Don't worry, I'll help you also with it. My husband has an autoimmune condition, a very, very rare one, especially for men. And the condition very common in women, but not in men. Plus, his families on both sides are affected with cancer and other autoimmune conditions, due to which many have passed away. My mother's not too well too and has multiple illnesses, along with the need to not live anymore. For me, the idea of living with this fear of what can happen and possibilities reinforce the idea of death on a daily basis. I find it extremely difficult to live with this and want to understand how to deal with something like this. Okay. So here also, you write down what are your traumatic thoughts. What are the exact things that scare you? Okay. So when you re-understand that, when you go to a root memory, re-understand that, wipe it out, it all gets removed. Okay. I'll help you with this. Don't worry. And anybody else who's watching who has such problems, get in touch with me and I'll definitely help you. It's a course I have. It's called Erasing Trauma. And in this course, we'll go into all these details of how to do this. Okay. So don't worry. It's easily done in yoga. It's easily done within a week if you sit in focus. I have been extremely independent since a young age and also very passionate about a particular cause. And so I decided not to have any children. But now, considering old age and dependency, I'm concerned about how to manage my mind and the unknown future concerns. Good choice, not having any children. You have done the planet a service. The whole of life you have done a service, not having a kid. But of course, it's my personal view and you may not agree. Okay? And if you don't agree, then you already got a kid. Considering old age and dependency. Now see, maintaining your health is a part of yoga. It's basically diet, thought and exercise. Guys, write it down. Diet, thought and exercise. Your diet of thoughts and the amount of exercise that you do determines your life. That's it. Determines the quality of your life in your old age. So if you master these three, you can master having a great old life without dependency on anybody. It's definitely possible. Okay? Why not learn that? It's a lot easier than having kids, learning this. So I can teach you. And then I'm concerned how to manage my mind and the unknown future concerns. So if the future concerns are unknown, you wouldn't be concerned about them. You'll only be concerned about them when you have certain thoughts about them and you decided certain things about the future. It's called a future-based memory. So we can recontextualize those. Okay. So whatever you're constructing, we find out where did you learn that? And then we change the learning. And then you stop constructing such memories and then you'll be relaxed. Okay. Then you can respond to your life as it happens. Through your mind as creators, you can suddenly find real, genuine desire to work on and respond to. Wouldn't that be great? Yes, it would be great. And don't worry, I'll help you learn that. Living in the present is a great idea, but the truth is that knowledge about the past and the future prevents us from doing this more. And who said living in the present is a great idea? Not necessarily. Okay? What if your present is full of unpleasant stuff? Then what if it's Ganpati time and they're playing some noise outside? Present is no longer pleasant. So I'd rather like switch off and go into a fantasy at that point. Maybe. Yeah, so if the present is pleasant, then it's pleasant. But if it's not pleasant, then it's not pleasant. So knowledge about past and future is always there even in the present. Okay. So if your future is not looking bright, and that's when you start getting concerned. Not when in the present, you can't control your mind. The future has to look good, then you feel relaxed. Okay? So, if you have accepted that things are going to change and you're going to be a part of that change, you're going to be on team change, then you feel very nice about the future. And you look forward to it with joy. When knowledge is concerned with the existential reality of life, words, hence the fears. Okay, yeah. The fears are all thoughts and those thoughts need to be re-understood. Those ideas need to be relearned. That's how someone deals with something like this. Is there a way to ensure that we are not reborn? No, I don't know any way. Where do we go once we are dead? And how do we know what happens? Is it a concrete idea or a fantasy that we can build to help ourselves? When you die, the reality continues, your experience continues. You simply don't fall into the buzz or the mild shock of reality. Mild shock of reality is boring, so you'll immediately bring in your mind. And once you bring in your mind, you have a new reality. Okay? So, yeah. All right. Let's go, last question. Anonymous. Is it possible to get out of the cycle? Everybody is waiting to get out of life like it's a bloody toilet. Okay? So, don't worry. You can make life worth desirable. All right? That's how you get out of the cycle of thinking that you can get out of the cycle. That's what you should do. Ha! Okay, guys, it's been like a really, really marathon session. And let's see if there are any questions here. Two questions available in chat also above. Okay, Shweta, do you mind taking those questions and pasting it, because I lost the chat. Can you do that, please? Do you mind taking those questions, the two questions that I missed? Okay, first one. Do stories decide our karma, or our karma decides what stories we construct until we are aware of what we are constructing? So whatever I answer to this will be a story, right? So you can construct the story. Next question. What's the next question? How do you work with your everyday energy to keep it in the spirit of movement and change, even when engaged in certain mundane tasks, by practicing yoga, right? That's how it's done. And I have several courses on offer which help you to do this. The first one is erasing trauma that makes you think that you need the security of things not changing. You find all of those trauma and erase it. And just with the erasing trauma course, this can be achieved, Katie. Next, what does it mean when there is a sudden scent around the person who dies? Somebody asked me privately. Okay, so this is... it just means that you've connected to some kind of spiritual energy, okay? All spirits are very strong in smell, and we start connecting to them. So then there is a being around who doesn't have a body, and the maximum they can manage in terms of a body is a smell. This is how spirits contact us, usually by smell. Some of the spirits from the lower lokas can come and give us a push as well, you know, physically, but many of them just come with a smell. So there is a need for communication if you're getting a smell. So please start talking, saying, hey, I'm listening. Do you want to like send thoughts into my head so I know what you're saying, and just relax, and then you can start talking to that spirit, right? Cool. Now, Kunal asks, how is Yama and yoga different from Yama and mythology? I don't think you're talking about Yama and Niyama, right? You're talking about the god of death, Yama. So Yama is supposed to be somebody who escorts souls to their destiny, right? And there are two things that there is, Yama and Yami also, okay? But in yoga, they don't carry that much importance. You can determine what we are. Let's think of it like this. Yama and Yami are the concierges of this of the bardos. Okay, so you can contact them. But if you have a guru, then most likely the guru is your concierge and takes you around. Okay. Hope I answered you, Kunal. In mythology, Yama is supposed to be the only concierge, but there can be other concierges. If you come from a Nath lineage like me, then you get a Nath yogi to show you around. So Anonymous says, I got this experience of scent when my grandmother expired. Okay, she was trying to talk to you. You can even talk to her now and ask her, hey, sorry, I got your message when you died. What are you trying to say? And she'll tell you. Okay. So, okay, cool. All right. Any more questions? Shall we call it a day? Now here, I know nobody wants to know what's Yoga Nidra. What? If you want to know what's Yoga Nidra and how you can learn it, type YN. If anybody wants to know about Yoga Nidra, type YN. Otherwise, I'm going to close this for today. Okay. A lot of people want to know about Yoga Nidra. Okay. All right, guys. So, Yoga Nidra is a course that I'm teaching, and it helps you to deal with all of these things. You can see it's very useful, and practicing Yoga Nidra can give you a lot of relief from the various trauma that you're undergoing, the various wrong ideas that you have. And guess what? You get unlimited WhatsApp support from me during the duration of the course. So the course is a total of 1 year, okay? And it's not an imposing course. You only have to attend one-hour session, not even a 1 hour. Sometimes it can drag on to an hour, but I stop talking at 25 minutes. And then if you got questions, it drags on like this. Okay, so the Yoga Nidra course is on Saturdays. And it's already begun. Everything is in a learning platform. So you log on to that learning platform and then you learn from there. You start following the videos week by week. You do the work. You get the videos, you do the work. You get the videos, do the work. Get the videos, do the work. And before you know it, you're having these out-of-body experiences, you have understanding about life, you calm down, you get focused on your genuine need. And that's the power of Yoga Nidra. Yoga Nidra is a very premium Nath Yoga practice. which I've been wanting to teach, and a lot of people have come forward. Right now, I think I have close to 30 students, and I'm very happy because they're making really good progress, even in the first week. So it's been 1 week since it started. If you want to join in and start with the first week's work, then what I want you to do is understand the following. Please pay attention and write down carefully the link. I'm going to give you the link and I'm going to tell you exactly what amount to pay. So first, I want you to pay a certain amount, and that will cover the first 3 months where we are preparing you. We're preparing your mind for Yoga Nidra. And after 3 months, we'll start the Yoga Nidra course. Okay, so make a note of these amounts. The initial amount is 2,402. And if you want to pay it, you have to go to, so that I have a record of it, please go to this website, let me check the link. Just hang on 1 minute. Yes, that's right. So you'll get to a page that says Mahashivratri Sadhana, okay? Which is, you'll get to a page called Mahashivratri Sadhana, where it says suggested fees 5001, but you can pay anything you want there. So go there and make this exact code 2402. Why 2402? It's my birthday, 2402. Okay, so you pay 2402 and then I'll start you on the first 3 months. I'm not going to ask you for any payment till June. So mid-June is when you will make a payment of 25402. 25402 for the whole year. So if you don't have that money, start saving it from now and make sure that you pay me in June if you want to learn Yoga Nidra. But in a year, and this includes certification, guys, I'm going to certify you as a practitioner of Yoga Nidra based upon your scores on the learning platform, the assignments you get based on that. I'm going to certify you also. And once you get that certificate, you can use Yoga Nidra to help people to heal. You can go and teach Yoga Nidra if you want. I don't have a problem with it. Yeah, you can do all sorts of stuff, but as long as you credit the akhada, you'll understand the importance of the lineage. Okay, so you won't be able to just go start a lineage of your own. If that's your goal, don't come, because you have to stay connected to the lineage, and that's how you learn. You should be proud to be associated with the Nath lineage. Okay, so once you graduate from this program, I will initiate you into the Nath lineage and certify you also. So that's the agenda for the Yoga Nidra. But basically, to practice some kind of spirituality that's practical, that helps you deal with the actual problems of life and is not just giving you moral science lectures and some kind of rules to follow unnecessarily and gambling. Okay, there's no gambling in Nath Yoga. Certainly, you will know. One of the great spiritual masters, he said, if you want to learn how to die, you have to learn how to live, and you have to die every day and practice it. So what he was saying is, you've got to practice Yoga Nidra, you've got to practice getting out of the confines of this body and actually looking at the construct of memories that become our reality for our mind and be able to change that. And that's called Yoga Nidra. All right, so if you want to go and register, go pay 2402 today. And I will put you on the course today evening. And that's the scene. Now, any more questions? If you got any more questions, ask your question. If you don't have any question, write NQ, no questions. If all of you write NQ, then it's thank you very much for watching. And then I'm going to leave. Okay, any questions? Any questions? You got questions? Which you've been holding on to and not asked? If you got no questions, please type NQ so that we can end. Okay, NQ, NQ. Thanks a ton. NQ, 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 NQ. All right. Looks like a fruitful discussion. I hope this opened your mind. This one got recorded, so I'm going to put up the recording. Please, Katie says I might have questions later. You know how to contact me, guys. If you got questions later, just like pop it by me. I'm very happy to answer when I get free time. Okay, so please look out for the recording. Take this recording, share it with whoever you want to share it with, who you want to liberate from the nonsense. And let's have another rocking session next week. Stay on the group and stay good. Yeah, can you share the flowchart? Yes, of course. And share it on the group, guys. Okay? Thank you very much for being a part. You guys are eliciting some awesome knowledge from Nath Yoga, and I'm so grateful to you guys. I'm so grateful. I cannot thank you enough. Thank you, thank you, thank you for making these weekly sessions possible, attending it, and making it worth my while. All right, bye. Joining my courses and signing up, learning with me. I just love it. I love the ecosystem we have. Thank you, everybody. You're all great. You're all lovely. You're all beautiful. And I will see you again next week. Thank you very much.